Hello, viewers. You are welcome to Sahara TV here in New York City. And we are going directly to talk about hot topic of the day, and which is the proposed dialogue between the Islamic sect Boko Haram in Nigeria and the federal government of Nigeria. As you almost have heard, there's been a lot of information, sometimes rumors, sometimes true and sometimes misleading about proposal by the sect, which is based in northern Nigeria, to have some kind of dialogue with the federal government of Nigeria. And to take this away with me today, I have Pastor Olalu Akande, who is he wears many hats. He's a journalist and editor of Empire Newswire in New York, and he's also the North American Bureau Chief of The Guardian. And recently, he became the leader of the Christian Association of Nigerians in America. And this group has been pushing strongly to fight against Boko Haram. And we also have on the line from Kaduna, Comrade Shehu Sani, who today will be talking about the real issues regarding Boko Haram. And he's the president of hello, Comrade.
Civil Rights Congress of Nigeria.
Civil Rights Congress of Nigeria. I apologize. I should know that, as a matter of fact. So, and we just want to go into this. Let me talk to you first, comrades. You have heard the news too many times already about the so-called proposed dialogue between the Nigerian government and Boko Haram. And each time we hear this, it always comes from one strange guy who speaks very good English, proposing to speak with the federal government of Nigeria. What do you know at this point? Is this real or just fake?
Well, thank you very much. First of all, when this issue of proposal came to the public glare,
yes,
one thing someone like me thought the government should do, first of all, is to authenticate the source of this proposal.
Yes.
And then by that they can verify the credibility of it. But I was very surprised that a proposal was forwarded by 3 p.m. And then 4 hours later, an acceptance was offered by the government. And for someone like me, I do not think that offer is credible.
Okay.
For a number of reasons. One of which is the person who is said to be making the offer.
Yes.
Has never been heard in the hierarchy of the insurgent group.
Yes.
And secondly, for such a group, if it is not their leader that speaks on behalf of the group, through the channels which he has been used to,
yes,
certainly I will raise a doubt over it. And then another point is that since the offer was made to the time of the acceptance and beyond, there has never been a let-up in the violence.
Yes.
People are still being killed.
Yes.
Places are still being bombed.
Yes.
And the violence is continuing unabated, as if there has never been offer or acceptance. So first and foremost, I have to doubt the credibility of that offer.
Yes.
And I think, in my own view, it's possible to be one of those camps that have been in the place since this violence has started. Because there have been a lot of people that are actually cashing in into this violence with the aim of defrauding the government. Oh, and some of the proposals were even forwarded by security agencies. And many things are being manipulated, and all has not in any way contributed towards ending the violence other than the civil people.
Yes.
And giving a false sense of hope.
Yes.
While the bombings are continuing. So there is clearly the Boko Haram industry.
Yes.
And a mediation industry. And a security industry. All that is coming out from the insurgency. And people are actually profiteering from the violence and the bloodshed that is actually going on here.
Hold your thought there, because we have Pastor Lalu Akande here in the studio, who set up recently a group that is meant to push the U.S. government and, you know, mobilize Nigerians, Christians, because Christians have mostly been the target of these attacks. What do you think about the legitimacy of this proposed or so-called dialogue, Pastor Lalu Akande?
Yeah, thank you very much, Comrade Shuore, for inviting me here. And I must say that what I have seen about Sahara TV just before I answer your question has been very impressive, and we must commend your effort and the effort of your team. I have no doubt in my mind that Sahara TV is going to hit the waves in a very big way very soon. Okay. Now, the Christian Association of Nigerian Americans was formed, you know, just to give a quick background, sometimes in September 11th specifically this year, by Nigerian Christian leaders, community leaders, professionals here in the United States, coming together to say, look, it seems that one of the major targets of Boko Haram terrorism are Christians, and they are killing Christians in the drove. And we thought, as Christians here, are we supposed to just watch as they slaughter our brethren? So that was why we formed the association. And I'm the executive director. The leader of the association is Pastor James Fadele. Now, as to the question of this offer, very clearly, we seem to have forgotten that the U.S. government has already designated three leaders of Boko Haram as terrorists. And so we are surprised and shocked that the Nigerian government is beginning to meddle with terrorists. Now, everybody knows that this is a terrorist organization run by terrorists. So just in addition to what Comrade Sonny said, apart from the fact that we can't even say that this guy speaking, purportedly speaking on behalf of Boko Haram, is indeed their spokesperson, apart from that, Boko Haram is a terrorist organization. You do not negotiate with terrorists. But indeed, to your question, I don't think this is a credible offer of talks.
Comrade Sonny, I want to ask you very quickly, because you have in the past come forward to say you're willing to actually facilitate dialogue and negotiate with the group. This was a long time ago, and the government has not been honest and credible about it. Have you had any contact in recent times to be able to ask if these guys are actually the ones speaking these days? Because as one senator recently mentioned, there are different groups of Boko Haram, like you said, that's become an industry. Mm. As a matter of fact, a friend of mine in Abuja recently said that it is the Aso Rock branch of Boko Haram that came out with the latest proposal. And the government, interestingly, reacted to that yesterday. Okay. So, Comrade, have you been able to find out by way of, you know, I know it's a maze to get across to these guys because they are deeply underground, if this is legitimate? Because I know recently, even though they did not react to this, they reacted to an allegation that they killed the general in Maiduguri. So we're surprised that they didn't react to this, but they were quick to react to the fact that they were not responsible for the death of that general. Do you have any information from Boko Haram regarding the legitimacy of the proposed dialogue at this point?
Yes. You see, first of all, the legitimacy of dialogue itself.
Yes.
Well, for someone like me, as a human rights activist who have been in and out of jail fighting to see democracy is in place.
Yes.
I believe people like us have a stake to see to it that Nigeria remains one and democracy continue to thrive.
Yes.
Now, ordinarily, what we would simply have done, people like us here, is to condemn every attack and also call for 2 minutes silence whenever it happens.
Hmm.
And what I have observed in the North, that there is a regime of fear and silence.
Hmm.
For the very fact that it is not that people don't want to speak out, but there is the fear. If you speak out, this is what will happen to you, and you have no protection.
Hmm.
And I also want people to understand, when people up North here said there should be dialogue with Boko Haram. It is not to say that people are aiding and abetting terrorism. But when you live in this part of the country, when you're, where you see soldiers guarding police stations and police barracks, so if you volunteer to speak out or to stand up for something else, what happens to you and your family? Will the state that is being protected, because when they say there are security agents everywhere, the security agents in North are simply protecting government officials, government buildings, and protecting their families. So this is why this happened like this. Now, for the second, whether the offer is authentic or not. Well, if you look at the, if you study the way terrorist groups work, or insurgents group, it's not in an insurgency 2 plus 2. Doesn't become 4. You don't say, it's not like an NGO or political party, whether something is done today and you expect them to deny it tomorrow. They do not work like this. How they work is, you look at it, a typical case. If there is a drone attack in Western Pakistan, the first thing the U.S. security forces will do is to say, and to make a guesswork and say the leader of the group has been killed. Now, the group knew that those who made the attack don't know whether they have succeeded or not. But a statement from the group will show that the target is still alive, and then will give now the attackers the opportunity to go and continue to search him where he is or not. So the group, the way they operate, it's not that when somebody make a wrong claims against them, tomorrow they will come out. But what I know very well, if they are, if this offer is genuine and sincere, there could not have been the attack in Kaduna, the church. There could not have been the killing of Shua. There could not have been the bombing that is going on in Yobe and Borno State now. And there could have been clear that some of these gunmen who are riding on motorbikes, moving around, looking at their tire, searching for targets, there could have been at least been a little a reduction in this violence. But it's very clear to me that most likely we may hear, until and unless we hear from the leader of the group, which most likely he may respond as things are going on now, because an offer was made, the names of people to mediate were given. And the leader of that names was General Mahmoud Buhari, who came out categorically and rejects such an offer. So I think logically it is predictable that certainly the group will make a statement at their own time. But what we should understand is that some of these things here are very complex, because I will not be very surprised that some of these issues do come from the government. Because if someone will pick a phone call and gather journalists in Maiduguri and speak for almost 2 to 3 hours with all the billions of naira which we are spending on security, and nobody can say and detect using all the modern technology and whatever, this is where this person is. And even shockingly enough, the Nigerian Television Authority, NTA, and government media were in the forefront of even giving more publicity to what this spokesperson is saying or doing. And nobody is searching for him. Nobody is doing anything for him. I think what we should look at it clearly, that there are a lot of things which need to be answered. And we shouldn't forget, some few to 4 to 5 months ago, there was a scam in the name of talks with Boko Haram in Saudi Arabia, whereby it was broadcasted and the government made a lot of statement about it. The Minister of Information made statement, the spokesperson of the president made statement, as if they knew that someone was even assuring that this violence is coming to an end. We are in talks. For me, when I saw them doing that, I knew that the scam is either made in Asofok, or they have been scammed to believe that something like that is going on. While those of us who are on the ground, who always hear bombs flying over our heads and gunmen moving around, knew that what is being said is simply false.
Hmm. Well, comrade, thank you so much. Hold it there, and let's go back to Pastor Lalo. Like you heard it. You know, I think some of the most cogent point he made is the difference between what the group says and when there's a major scam like this, how the government gives it publicity to give an impression that everything is okay. And he made another great point that when you talk about security in Nigeria today, the security men are not protecting ordinary people, they are protecting themselves and government installation and government officials. You know, so, I mean, how do we react to this? How do you get your backers in the U.S., supporters in the U.S. to understand directly the real problems? Because here he's saying that this is more complex than we look at it on. I mean, as you can see, this is more than what we see on the surface. It looks like there's a lot of fraud, scam, and manipulation going on, you know, of public opinion and all of that.
Yeah, I mean, thank you. Very, very, very clearly, Comrade Sonny has spoken to a lot of the issues regarding the complexity of the offer itself on the one hand, and government's own seeming eagerness to give an impression that they are doing something about it. Look, what is very clear is, number one, the Nigerian government, as it is constituted, you know, is incapable of providing adequate, the basic protection of life and security. This government has proven that it cannot by itself give Nigerians protection of life and property. And so that is why they will be eager in order to cover up for that inability. The government will be eager to be seen to be doing something. Because like Sonny said very rightly, why will it be difficult for the Nigerian government, its security agencies, you know, well-funded for that matter, to be unable to track down the guy who spoke to journalists for that long, the guy who was reported by the government's own NTA. Why is it difficult for them to be able to establish his credibility or lack of it?
Yes.
So much so that few hours after that, they are responding, accepting a bogus offer,
yes,
a fake offer. Government is meant, I mean, based on the amount of money actually, that you know they spend on security, they should be able to track the guy down, know exactly who he is. Mm-hmm. They should be, in fact, before he spoke, they should have known,
yes,
who he is.
Exactly.
You know, I mean,
where he was speaking from.
Where he was speaking from, where is his location?
Yes.
Now, if they have this information, then they would have been able to determine the credibility of, or lack of it, of his claims.
Yeah.
Now, for government to now quickly go and accept the offer without any cessation to the hostilities, to the violence, shows very clearly that the government has lost its, they don't have the capacity, they by themselves, the Nigerian government by itself cannot handle this Boko Haram issue, nor has it been able to handle the basic protection of life and property of Nigerians.
That's one thing, and like we keep saying here, it's I mean, Boko Haram is just the biggest picture of insecurity in Nigeria today. Everywhere you go in Nigeria, there's insecurity. And this is obvious. I mean, there's kidnapping going on east and west of Nigeria today. There's armed robbery, you know, I mean, as we've never seen before. And all kinds of, in fact, Nigeria has graduated from a country of petty crimes to, you know, high-tech crime now. And of course, you know, you match this together and you have, you know, on top of it, a very, very powerful, corrupt government in place that is always willing to shell out and steal and rob the people. And this is what is happening with Boko Haram. We heard from a source that the Saudi Arabia bogus security, I mean, offer cost Nigeria almost $300 million. But they won't disclose this to the public, and they won't disclose other things as to how much they're spending. What we know is that each time a new national security officer, advisor is appointed, he says that the treasury is empty from his predecessor. And then you find out that the predecessor has bought homes in Abuja and built mansions and, you know, is living large. Mm-hmm. Anyways, comrade, we would like to just find out from you again, what is the solution to this? We have read you so many times where you say, you know, the president should just give you a call. And this problem might end, that you can make a call and you can arrange, you know, what is honest and truthful dialogue between Boko Haram and the government. Why do you think the Nigerian government is not willing to take your offer? Why are they hell-bent on going through the more expensive, right, the more deceptive and misleading route? Why?
Well, for anyone who is going through your website, he has seen how in the beginning of this year I've spoken elaborately about the group and also the possibility of peace. But I'm not very sure now that I'll be willing to be part of this, because now the options we have given is that if you have an insurgency, there are two options. You either use force or you use dialogue. The use of force to crush an insurgency has worked in places like Algeria after the annulment of 1992 election, and it has also worked in crushing the rebellion in Sri Lanka. Now, in a country like ours, where you have everything being turned into a business, including the lives of people, innocent lives, we have reached a point whereby wherever you see any idea of, or mutation of any idea of a peace talks, it has an element of some persons who simply want to cash into the problem. So in this kind of an atmosphere, it's like an insurgency that has been mixed with fraud. Hmm. Insurgency from the side of the insurgent and then fraud from the side of the government. Hmm. And nobody in this kind of situation can actually solve such a problem so easily. When I said, if I'm given a call, because I know it very well, but I have a sincere formula that is honest, that is genuine, and people whom, if the government has sat down with them, this problem will have come to an end for a very long time. Hmm. But what was very clear is that the government actually reached out to those people, and the whole process was sabotaged. When Dr. Dete Ahmed was mandated by the group to speak and to initiate a dialogue, right when the issue started, it was completely sabotaged. Hmm. Now, when the president went to South Korea, sometimes in the beginning of this year, in a nuclear summit, he said the Boko Haram violence is going to end by June. By such a president making such a statement, it's clear that he has been misinformed by some certain persons who said they are doing one thing or another. Hmm. And if you look at him, he has always been saying soon. If he says September now and September passes in December, December will go to January. He has always been shifting dates to which this problem is coming to an end. Now, nobody on the ground in the north believe whatever the government is saying. Nobody believe whatever it is, because we know it very well that nothing has been done. For example, governors in the north today have found an excuse to not to build roads, not to build schools, not to build hospitals, in the name of spending on security. Hmm. And one of the governors was even saying he spent about 300 million naira every week until a commissioner of police came out openly and said they don't even have a functional vehicle to move around.
Wow.
You come to some of the states in the north where about 50% of the budget is going on security. You find out that you see a patrol vehicle stuck in one place. You would think that it's moving. It doesn't even have a tire.
Hmm.
The tires are even not working.
Wow.
And these guys move on motorbikes armed, and they move and get at their targets at will. So when you see when an insurgency meets a group of scammers, so we'll simply be going round the cycle. Look at what has happened recently in a church in Kaduna. Hmm. With all the first priority of the governor has always been from the issue of security, and he's spending millions of taxpayers' money on it in the name of security. But one person, psychopath that loaded his own vehicle with a bomb simply went into a church and killed so many persons. Now, in a situation like this, what can any person do? Nowadays, even on the issue of Boko Haram, you can hardly call anybody in the north for him to confidently discuss with you out of fear. Because he knows if he condemns them, if he opposes them, or if he says anything, they will come after him. If you end up giving information, this is where one of the members of students can be seen and can be arrested. Don't think you will go back to your house. Because before the evening time, they knew who gave the information and they come after you.
Hmm.
So in this kind of atmosphere, people are simply interested in anything that will bring the violence to an end.
Wow.
And one of which is if talks and dialogue will work, it could have been fine. But in a situation now whereby defense contractors, security entrepreneurs, people with all sorts of gadgets coming into security offices in Abuja, one gadget that is imported from Israel, one from Russia, one from this, costing millions and millions of dollars. So in this kind of atmosphere, I do not think that we have taken the path that will end this violence.
Yes.
Now, the only way,
yes,
the only way which I believe now that is remaining is for people to end fear and silence, to stand up. And you cannot only stand up against the insurgents. You also have to do it against the joint task forces because they are committing as much atrocity as the group themselves.
Yeah.
What is very clear today is a bomb explodes in a street, on a street, all the people around that street will be punished. Either their house will be burnt, all soldiers will go into their house and arrest them, and from there you will never hear the name of any person again.
Wow. Let's quickly hold that thought, because you mentioned something very crucial, and I want Pastor Lalo to, because he is opposed to dialogue. He says, don't dialogue with terrorists. But you've heard our brother comrade say, listen, you know, the Nigerian government has no capacity to crush this guy. And he actually clearly stated that we can either defeat this guy by way of dialogue, defeat the violence, or by way of force. And I even read in the Guardian of the UK this morning that the Nigerian army that is supposed to lead the crushing of the Mali insurgents have no capability to fight, and it's going to delay the fight. How do you rely on a government to do this for you, except if you want the U.S. government to intervene directly?
Yeah, and this is where we come in.
Yeah.
We certainly understand what Nigerians are going through, you know, which Comrade Sonny has even reminded us, you know, the fact that people are living in fear, the fact that government doesn't seem to be capable by on itself to resolve this issue. Now, we believe in the Christian Association of Nigerian Americans that it is time for the United States government to wield the big stick. It's imperative to designate Boko Haram as a foreign terrorist organization. And people say, you know, what would that do? Number one, many people don't pay attention to the fact that Boko Haram is maintained by a continuous inflow of financing. You know, the kind of weapons, you know, that these people are using, you know, they are not made in Africa. They're not made in Nigeria. There is a movement of weapons from country to country, which also suggests that there's some serious financing. There are some big pockets that are financing Boko Haram, whether they are politicians, whether they are hegemonic interests. The fact remains that there are some serious financial and political interests sustaining Boko Haram with weapons and with financing. And so if the U.S. Does the right thing, which is to designate the organization itself as a terrorist organization, they have the capacity, and thank God that we are Americans too, they have the capacity to go after the financiers, to intercept the movement of weapons, you know, because the Nigerian government cannot do these things. That is why we are asking that the U.S. government should do what is right, not just designate three of the leaders of Boko Haram, but they should designate the group itself as a foreign terrorist organization, in which case they become enemies of the national interest of the United States, which they have. You know, so when that happens, it will send a very important message to those who are financing Boko Haram. It will send very important message to everybody involved that the game is up. That is why we said that the important thing is for the U.S. to designate Boko Haram as a foreign terrorist organization. In addition to that, this is a terrorist organization, and we are opposed to negotiating with terrorists. Now, General Buhari, who this bogus spokesman asked to mediate, has said that he's not going to mediate for the same reason that Buhari is saying that I don't know these folks. I don't know Boko Haram. Even Buhari cannot stand in for them. So it's a problematic proposition to be talking about negotiating with faceless people. But even if the leaders, the two leaders of this organization come out, I don't believe that negotiation is what is going to bring a solution. Because these people, by their mandate or by their agenda, I'm sorry, they've made it clear that what they want to do is to impose Sharia on Nigeria. They are not making, they are not joking around. And so what are we going to be talking about at the table? What are the issues? They are killing Christians, they are killing innocent people, and they continue to kill them. Why should we be talking with people who are committing, who are perpetrating violence? We should use force. And when I say force, I'm not talking of the kind of force that they will go be attacking innocent people. Governments should use, you know, a measured, targeted force. And the international community, especially the United States, should step in and do what is right and label this group as a foreign terrorist organization. Now, there's a solution on the part of Nigerians, especially Nigerians here in the U.S. Then this is one of the reasons why we formed CANAN, Christian Association of Nigerian Americans. We need to come together to mobilize ourselves and to raise our voice. Many of us are Americans. We have an interest in this government. We are citizens. And so we need to interact with our congressmen. We need to interact with our mayors. We need to interact with senators and tell them that we need them to do what is right, to compel the Secretary of State, Hillary Clinton, to designate Boko Haram as a foreign terrorist organization. Once that is done, that's a very important signal that is sent to their financiers.
Yes, good. Comrade, I wanted to react to that very quickly, that regarding if designating Boko Haram as a foreign terrorist organization will immediately put an end or at least help to solve this problem, maybe force them even to redial. Like, what do you think about that?
Well, you see, when a nation is faced with this kind of crisis, it behoves on every person to proffer a solution on the way out of it. This insurgency is part of the challenges of our history and of our own era.
Yes.
Perhaps in the next 10 or 20 years, the problems of Nigeria may not be insurgency.
Yes.
In the history of a people, at every time, you have challenges, and I believe the challenge of today is that of insurgency and terror. So people have the right to give their own opinion. But what I'm giving you now is that if designating the group as a terror organization will address the problem, well, so be it. But the fact on the ground is that the young man with an AK-47 who is on a motorbike moving around, he doesn't even know what is designing any group as a terror organization. All he knows what to do is what his imam told him to do, and he will simply go after people. And one thing we should also understand clear is that it is not possible. Americans will not come to Maiduguri and Yobe Street and fight for us. They cannot come. They cannot deploy troops. And even if they're going to use drones, before they get one Boko Haram member, they will get over 100 people who are not members of Boko Haram. Hmm. They will go after people in the wedding party. They will go after people in birthday parties. They will go after people wherever they feel an information moves around. That is where they will be, their targets will be. So when we say talk to this group, for someone like me, I have said it in black and white to to my correspondences with some of them, that it is weird for anybody to think that Nigeria will be an Islamic country. And what many people do not even understand is that there are many sects in northern Nigeria, many Islamic sects. There are some Islamic sects that are vehemently opposed to that group as much as the Christian were. Just like you know, Jehovah Witness, Amok, Anglican, and Catholics all have their differences, of which someone from a distance will say all of them are Christians. The same thing. You have some sects that don't even pray in other sects. You have some sects that do not accept the leadership of other sects. So even imposing it, not even in the whole of Nigeria, but in the north itself, is a problem. Because a Shiite man and a Sunni man do not see eye to eye. But perhaps someone from outside will not understand and will not know, except when you go deep to study all these issues. So the group itself, the sect itself, is a marginal sect in the northeastern part of Nigeria. But because of their approach and the taking of arms and this violence have made them more prominent than any other person. But when people say talk to them, is the very fact that they have seen the use of force has not spared them either. For every one Boko Haram member that is killed by security agencies, almost 10 innocent persons have to die. And for every one security agent that is killed by Boko Haram, almost 10 innocent persons also have to die. So the casualty figure in this ideology of the use of force is on innocent persons, not the security agents, not the Boko Haram. And that is why people do not have time for theories, for predictions, and for conjectures.
Comrade.
All they want is let the guns be silenced and let this bomb come to an end, whatever means that can be used. So this is what it is.
Yes, you want to jump
in. Yeah, comrade, just to make it very clear, Christian Association of Nigerian Americans, we are not asking the U.S. government to deploy drones to Nigeria. We are actually affirming the independence of Nigeria. And so we are not supporting the use of U.S. troops or asking for it or asking for drones, no. But when you use the example of that young chap that is carrying an AK-47, comrade, the question is, who gave it to him? We are saying that when there is a foreign terrorist designation of Boko Haram, there are people who are supplying these weapons, who are paying the money. The chap just didn't get the AK-47. Then we get the signal. These are people who have the fat pockets. So when the U.S., for instance, says that, look, this organization is now known as a foreign terrorist organization, and the people who are backing them, the people who are not on the scene, they will get that message. This is the language they understand. And so the way to stop those weapons from getting to that young chap is to go and deal with the people who are supplying him that weapon. And that is one of the things that a foreign terrorist designation of Boko Haram can do. It will send a very serious message to the backers, to the financiers of Boko Haram.
Let me also ask you another question quickly. Like, since this is your initiative is seen as a Christian initiative, and there are people who are non-Christians and non-Muslims who would also love to participate, you know, doesn't this alienate those people?
That's a very good question, Shore. And it's one of the things that I was hoping to get the opportunity to explain.
Yes.
Even though we are a Christian Association of Nigerian Americans, we are going to be working with everyone, including Muslims. One of our agenda is to actually reach out to Nigerian Muslims in the U.S. to say, listen, we have no problem against Islam. Many of us, you know, we have people in our family who are Muslims. I mean, I grew up with Muslim cousins. So the issue is not against Islam. The issue is not against Muslim. The issue is that they are killing innocent Nigerians, and we will work with everyone who is interested in trying to stop this by any means reasonably possible.
Listen, comrade and Pastor Lalo Akande, this has been a very, very interesting morning discussing the issue of Boko Haram. This is one of our biggest security threat now to both the unity of Nigeria, the security of its people, and the betterment of the Nigerian society, because the entire North has almost been destroyed and is spreading across Nigeria as we speak. And we want to let you know, Pastor Lalu Akande says, if you want to participate in this process of forcing the U.S. government hands to designate Boko Haram as a terrorist organization, you can go to KenanUSA.org and participate in that process. And also, you can always contact us at SaharaReportersTV at gmail.com, and we'll pass your information to Pastor Lalu Akande. And also, if you need to reach Comrade Sonny, you can also reach him through us. Comrade, last question to you is, since you've been very vocal about these issues, have the U.S. government or the European governments contacted you to say, even if the Nigerian government doesn't want to help, they can't help themselves, please help us here, you know, help talk to us? Because we know that these Western governments do go behind governments of countries like Nigeria, where government is ineffective, to look for civil society leadership to help in resolving some of this problem. Have you received those kind of thing? Have you been invited, talked to, or empowered to you know, to make your own idea of how to solve this problem available to them, or facilitate that?
Well, not to that level of finding the security resolution to this problem, to that sense. But in the sense of being invited to talk, to present a paper and to make speeches, that one is, it has always been there. But what I know it very clearly is that the solution to this problem actually is still possible if we can be honest and sincere with ourselves. Nobody can say that in the whole of Maiduguri or Borno State or wherever it is, that people there don't know who these guys are. People know, but now if you know, what becomes of it? If you know you have, and you have a child, you have a son, you have a wife, and you have a family, and out of 10 members of their family, 9 people say, if you keep your mouth shut and don't get us into trouble, what are you going to do? So I want to, by that, I'm giving you an idea of what it is. The climate of fear is and silence, it is because there is no confidence from the side of the government that actually people who may volunteer to find solution to this problem are even themselves protected. You can even imagine people who genuinely will offer to bring about peace, they themselves would get calls from different places. And they were being asked and threatened, why do you want to do this? What is your business in it? Are you a member of the federal government? Are you what and what? So what the pastor is saying is a good effort, but I think they should broaden in with others who also share their opinion in this part of the country. But what I can tell you very well is that as far as the people on the ground here are concerned, for every day is one bomb or one person is killed or hundreds of people are killed. I think what they are interested in is any way to which this problem can come to an end. I think it will be very much welcome. And the contribution of Nigerians that are outside of Nigeria, I think, is very much needed. But if you look at the government, what it's doing, the interest is that how can the West support the government with more money? And even the last NSC has, in the article, one of the articles he has written in the Washington Post, I have read it, is about his line of thinking is for the West to support Nigerian security agencies monitoring with equipment and other things. And when it comes to that, you know that we are actually not getting there. If 25% of national budget is pumped into security and still hundreds of people are being killed every day, so where is the money going? So I think this is what we should understand. As long as this problem becomes a business where people are making money out of it, I don't think we will get over it. And I said it very well to them. If the essence of picking up your arms is the injustice that has been done to you, I believe that it is high time for you to sit down and present them. When you come to the table, there are things you can achieve. There are things you can never achieve. What I know very well, and I'm saying it here, I'm not speaking from Lagos, and I'm not speaking from London. I'm speaking from the North, where people are hearing me. What I said is very well. Even if half of the people of Nigeria have been killed, Nigeria will still not be an Islamic state. But what we need is that you can present other issues that you want to be discussed, and it can be discussed. And about weapons coming into northern part of Nigeria and people getting them, it's true what the pastor is saying. And in fact, with the downfall of Gaddafi, the whole thing has become worse. With Barbers coming in from Niger, the northern part of Nigeria, it has not made the situation worse. And in that part of the country, Borno State, borders with Chad, where Chad has been for over 2 to 3 decades in civil war, most of the veterans in Darfur and eastern part of Chad find easy access to Maiduguri. So you can see that area and what it is. And with the Libyan crisis now and weapons moving down south, it has worsened the situation. So I think this is what we should look at in this aspect.
Thank you so much. And we're going to have the last word from Pastor Lalo Akande, and we'll wrap up this segment.
Yeah, it's just to, thank you, Showare, to offer a hand of fellowship to Comrade Shehu Sani, that we are actually interested in working with people like you who have a clear perspective on the situation on the ground. Like I said, you know, yes, we are a Christian association, but we are willing to work with everybody who is interested, because we want to promote peaceful coexistence between Nigerian Christians and Muslims. So I'm going to be getting in touch with you through Comrade Showare.
Everybody, thank you for watching this segment of Hot Topic, talking about Boko Haram in Nigeria and insurgency and how it is tearing the country apart. And, you know, one thing that's come out of this is how, I have no regret in saying it, how useless our government is in tackling security challenges affecting the people of Nigeria. If you want to reach out to Pastor Olalo Akande's group, you can reach them by CananUSA.org. It's CananUSA.org. And of course, you can reach us to debate this on Sahara Reporters, different channels. You can reach us on Facebook, Sahara Reporters. Twitter is Sahara Reporters as well. And Sahara TV1 is our Twitter handle for the TV segment. And, of course, you can call us by telephone, and you can reach us by Skype, which is sahara.tv. So please do not go away. Our next segment is coming up in a moment. Thank you for watching.
Thank you very much. All right. Thank you. Thank you so much.
If you're not informed,
you don't know where you come from.